Good evening and welcome! So glad to have you with us for Dramalogue Talking Theater, sponsored by Martin and Marlene Silver. We want to thank them specifically for underwriting, sponsoring this initiative for us. So thank you, Martin and Marlene. We appreciate your support. My name is Bruce Linzer. I am the manager of the Drama Workshop here at Palm Beach Dramaworks. And I have a commercial for you. We've got so much coming up, you're going to have a hard time keeping track of it all, because I know I am, so get your calendars out. This coming Monday evening at 7:30 p.m., that's the 9th of November, we have our interview with Lynn Nottage. That wraps up our Contemporary Voices series for this time around, the Lynn Nottage plays. We finally get to meet the woman herself and speak with her, so we're looking forward to that. That's this coming Monday, 7:30 p.m. We hope you'll tune in. Of course, tickets are free, but you do need to reserve your slot by either calling the box office or logging in online. Next week, we will not have a Dramalogue. So as we head into the holiday season, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that in just a second, we're going to go to an every other Friday for our Dramalogues. So next week, Friday the 13th, had nothing to do with it, but we'll avoid Friday the 13th, especially this year in 2020. So next week we will not have a Dramalogue, but we will be back on the 20th, Friday the 20th, with Gary Cadwallader. He is an actor, he's a director, and he's our director of education and community engagement. So that's Gary Cadwallader on Friday, November 20th at 7:30 p.m. As always, tickets are free. You do need to reserve your slot online or by calling the box office. By now, you have heard that we are doing Home for the Holidays, which is our three-play series of holiday-themed pieces that we're doing readings of. Those will be The Trip to Bountiful by Horton Foote. That'll be on Monday, November 30th at 7:30 p.m. The next week will be The Last Night of Ballyhoo by Alfred Urey. That's Monday, December 7th at 7:30 p.m. And then we're going to take a break for a week as we prepare for our big finale. Right before Christmas, we're going to do a reading of Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. And that's going to be Monday, December 21st at 7:30 p.m. And by that point, we're all going to be exhausted and we're going to take a break for the holiday. And we're looking forward to that as well. So we hope you'll join us for all of those. Of course, tickets are free for everything, but you do need to reserve your slot. Tonight's Dramalogue guest, playwright and theater critic Terry Teachout. I'm going to let Bill introduce him to you in just a second. But first, I want to thank the Tourist Development Council and the Cultural Council of Palm Beach County for supporting our online initiatives. We're grateful to them. And of course, to you, our audiences, who keep showing up for these. We are so grateful for the continued support that you give us. If you are in a position during this time that you can help support any of our initiatives, we do try to keep our initiatives free. But they do cost us money, of course, so like everything. So if you're able to help us, we would appreciate a donation on our website, or you can contact Carla Bryant. She's our director of development, and she'll be standing by. I would love to talk to you about how you can support everything that we're doing moving forward. And we've got a lot going on moving forward into the new year as well. We're excited to tell you about that at a later date. There will be a Q&A afterwards, so we hope you'll stick around for that. You'll look for the Q&A section there on your screen. You'll enter your question, and then we can take it from there. Please turn off your cell phones. As I always say, we have enough screens in our lives. Let's focus on this one for a short period of time and keep ourselves in the habit of turning off our cell phones when we go to the theater. And with that, it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to our producing artistic director, Mr. Bill Hayes. Bill, are you with us?
I'm trying.
Ah, there you are. You're not trying at all. I think you're
a... How are you doing, friend?
I'm very well. How are you?
I'm good. You said we're going to be exhausted. I'm exhausted already.
Exactly.
I'm just so glad to be here to escape politics.
Oh, amen to that.
I have not slept in 5 days. It's just making me crazy. So I'm glad to be here tonight with our friends and excited to interview the two-time Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright, Lynn Nottage, on Monday. That's going to be awfully exciting, and I'm sure it's going to be really well attended. I'm just thrilled to have our guest here tonight. He's listen out to all the stuff he does. He's an author, critic, biographer, playwright, librettist, stage director, web blogger, podcaster. He's the critic at large of Commentary. He's the author of Sightings, which is a column about the arts in America. It's biweekly in the Wall Street Journal. He's the theater critic of the Wall Street Journal. He's written for the National Review, the New York Times, among many other things. He's a panelist on Three on the Isle, a monthly podcast about theater in America that's sponsored by American Theater Magazine. He's a writer and contributor to many news sources and has written forwards in many books and also writes for many multiple magazines, too many to name here. Please welcome my dear friend and artist, Mr. Terry Teachout. How you doing, brother?
Bill, it's good to see you, and I wish I were there. I'm there virtually, but Palm Beach Dramaworks is like a second home to me, and I miss it very much.
We miss you, and I'm sure we have a lot of people watching tonight because you're part of the family.
I feel that way, too.
And ladies and gentlemen, Terry Teachout was a Zoom virgin until tonight. This is it. This is his first Zoom.
And you were all here for it.
And just for you guys.
and it doesn't take long to get Zoom fatigue. It doesn't take long, right, Bruce?
Oh, I don't know what you're talking about.
Bruce, thanks for being with us. Bruce is going to be our mission control tonight, Terry, as we go through some photos of a bit of your history.
Have fun.
How are you, friend?
All right. I'm keeping busy, incredible as it may sound.
Right.
My job has changed greatly, but I still do it every Friday. I still cover theater for the Wall Street Journal. What I cover now are webcasts of theatrical productions from all over the United States and sometimes England.
Right.
But I haven't missed a beat.
Well, Terry, everybody knows you as the esteemed theater critic. Our patrons know you because you've had two works done on our main stage. They've seen you in the lobby. They know you. They know you're a great guy. I think you have a heart as big as Manhattan, as far as I'm concerned. But this is an opportunity to pay tribute to those who've contributed to the success of Dramaworks. And you not only have as an artist, but you helped in a huge way raise our national profile as an organization, and we are grateful for that. So you've contributed so much on many levels. And I want to talk about the first time you came to Florida. And I believe we were the first theater that a New York paper came down to review a show, which was Eugene Ionesco's The Chairs. You want to talk about what inspired you to visit Florida?
Well, I realized there had to be theater in Florida in December and January, which is when things basically closed down in New York. And it occurred to me that it might be an interesting idea to see what there was to see. And so I called a friend of mine who was conversant with theater and said, what are the interesting companies? And yours came up. I saw that you were doing Ionesco's play, which Ionesco is one of my favorite playwrights.
Sure.
And I thought, okay, I'm game. What the hell? So I came. This was when you were in the storefront.
Yep. I think that was 2003, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that sounds about right. It was. I'd been in Florida before. I had been doing presentations, appearances at Rollins College in Winter Park, but I'd never been to South Florida. And I got there, and I thought, "This is a theater. What is this?" I came in, I sat down in that time. How many seats did that theater have?
Oh, at that time, that theater was 84 seats. Yeah. Now we're in the big house, 218.
Well, I mean, the ambition, I didn't know anything about Palm Beach. I mean, Palm Beach was like, the resort city for rich people. And the idea that you were doing UNESCO there fascinated me.
I think it's
so.
Go ahead.
Are you there?
No. Yeah. Do you hear me? I was interrupting you.
I hear you. Was there a dropout?
Okay.
No. I was just going to say that the idea of seeing UNESCO in a town like that seemed incongruous to me. So my wife Hillary and I showed up. I think we were both together for that trip, and you always know very quickly when a show is really good, when a theater, a company, they know what they're doing. usually within 5 to 10 minutes. And I realized immediately that regardless of any preconceptions I had about where I was seeing a really, really good presentation of one of the great plays of the century. And I said so in the journal later on. And in my traveling, because I was already covering theater all over the United States by then, when I see a company that good, I try to come back a year later and make sure it wasn't a fluke. And I think the second show I saw you do...
Was it Freud's Last Session?
I believe it was Freud's Last Session, which was new to me. I had never seen it before. And that was no fluke.
And no, and that first visit, it was not only the chairs. You did a sweep through the state. You went down to Gable Stage, and you saw the adding machine. Mm-hmm. And then you went to Florida Rep, and you saw Brian Friel's Dancing a Lunasa. And so you did big things.
Right, and Oslo Rep.
Pardon me? And you went to the Oslo?
And Oslo Rep as well.
Yes, but...
I make my decisions about what to review by what the shows are. And Florida just didn't seem to me, at that point I was too naive to know, that it was in fact a major center of American theater.
Well, that's what your article was
about. And I kept going to companies and kept being impressed by what I saw. And I finally, the journal liked the idea of my covering shows down in Florida, and it became an annual routine that Hillary and I would come down, spend some time on Sanibel Island, which is a place we both love. And fanning out from there, I would see shows all over the southern part of the state. And the quality, not just of you, although yours was remarkable, but the quality of all of them was quite consistently fine. And it became a regular part of my year to be in Florida in January. I never have regretted it.
I remember
the
first review you did of the chairs and then Gable Stage and Florida Rep. You, of course, wrote the reviews, but you also wrote on the front cover of the art section about, folks, don't underestimate Florida.
Yeah.
You know,
well, it seemed to me easy to do. I mean, I had done it, and I thought it was worth pointing out that directly, that no matter what you think Florida is, it's not just Disney World, it's not just beaches, it also turns out to be and still is a major center of American theater, as important as Chicago or Los Angeles or Washington, D.C. I mean, the really good towns for theater. You've got to move around if you want to see a lot of stuff. And one thing I didn't understand about Florida is how big it is. But I learned how to get from one place to another and plan ahead. And I don't think I've ever seen a bad show in Florida, to tell you the truth.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Not that I can recall.
We have a lot of great companies, and you are sure missed here at Palm Beach Dramaworks, my friend. It's always nice. We like to go back in time, to get to know a bit of your family and your journey as an artist, as a writer, as just developing as a human being. Now, you were born in Cape Girardeau, Missouri, right?
That was my birthplace. I'm having trouble both with your sound and video, Bill.
Uh-oh, that's not good. So... I'm going to assume...
You are frozen.
It's Bruce, can you tell me, are you having problems with me, or is it Terry's computer?
I am not. I think it's on Terry's end at this moment, because everybody's moving well right for me.
Okay, it could be, Terry, that your screen is...
I can hear you.
You can hear me, that's the main thing, so I'm going to just continue, and I'm going to assume that your computer is going to correct itself shortly. But then, how long were you in the Cape before you went and moved to Sykeston?
Well, I was born in Cape Girardeau. I grew up in Sykeston, which is a very small town, I guess about 10,000 people, in the southeastern corner of Missouri.
Right.
And I lived there until I graduated from high school and went off to college. But I am a true small town boy.
Yeah,
and I have deep roots there. In fact, my brother, now who's 4 years younger than me, now lives in the house where the two of us grew up. Mm-hmm. So I'm one of those people.
Oh, I didn't know that. You never told me that. That
from small town life is really important.
David. Yeah. So I think we actually have a photo. It's a postcard or something from that region. And what are we looking at here?
Yes. You are looking at what the main street of my hometown looked like when I was young. And it doesn't look much different from that now. That flag has 48 stars. We do have a mall on the edge of town now. But this looks like a small town. It is a small town. It's an our town kind of town. And I loved it and still do. Many people who grow up in small towns become alienated from them. They can't wait to shake the dust and get away. I have never felt like that, never in my life.
Yeah, I want to get into that in a little bit here, Terry, to talk about, you know, growing up and the kind of impact that that had on you. And eventually you said television had a significant impact on your life. But let's first talk just briefly about your grandparents. I think Albert and Grace Krosno, which was the maternal grandparents. Want to tell me about each set of grandparents?
Yeah, my mother's parents. They lived in a much smaller town. About, I don't know, a 15-minute drive away from Sykeston, a town of, I know the population is in two digits even now. They were both country folk from Kentucky. They farmed until my grandfather became a shoe factory foreman. He died in 1962. I didn't know him well. But my grandmother lived well into my adulthood, and they had a bunch of kids, a big family, and we did things as a family, always. We spent holidays together, Christmas Eve, the 4th of July, in this tiny town, Dielstadt. And I loved it. I loved my cousins. I had an idyllic childhood.
And were you? Did you say that Grandma Grace, was she the one you were closest to?
Well, I didn't really know Albert. I mean, he died when I was 5 or 6. So one thing I remember about him clearly is that he played banjo, and that was one of the first ways that I was exposed to the idea that a person can make music for himself. My grandmother, well, this will tell you about my grandmother, where she grew up. She was, like my mother, baptized in a river. So if you've seen those scenes from movies like Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, they're real.
Well, did he influence you in any way to become the musician that you became?
I think it must have been in the back of my mind. Not directly, and I had no aptitude for the banjo. They actually left it to me, but it's a tricky instrument, and I couldn't do anything with it. The immediate influence on me was my father's records. He had a lot of them, a lot of LPs, mostly of jazz and big band music. And there was a closet in our basement where he kept all of his old 78s, which he kept locked. And I figured out how to get that lock open with a coat hanger.
And we always figure it out.
Years later, he told me that he'd done it deliberately because it was forbidden fruit, and therefore I absolutely had to have it. But I discovered the jazz and swing of his youth through his records and became fascinated by it. I mean, usually, you know, kids my age don't listen to music like that, but I listened to a lot of it. And then I would have to have been in fifth grade, summer of fifth grade. This was back in the days when there were only three networks, and they did fine arts stuff on Sundays in the afternoon and then Ed Sullivan in the evening. And David Oistrakh and Sviatoslav Richter broadcast a recital from Lincoln Center, And Oistrakh was, of course, one of the great Russian violinists. He played the Brahms D minor sonata. And I thought first, what a piece. And then I thought, I wonder if I could play that instrument. The public school system in Sykeston had a really good music program, and they gave kids an aptitude test the second half of fifth grade, and I made a perfect score on it, which meant I could do whatever I wanted, and we had a string program. And I asked my parents, could I play violin? And that was my first instrument. I took to it. I went from school to having private lessons. There was a school orchestra. We had, they don't really have many more, but we had a community concerts series, mm-hmm. which brought second tier classical performers to our junior high school gymnasium to play. And there was a music store downtown. Mostly it sold pianos and instruments, but it had a couple of racks of classical records, and I would buy those with my allowance, and the public library had records, and I just suddenly, I couldn't get enough of music, all kinds of music. One summer, I talked the orchestra director into letting me take a bass home from the band room for the summer, and I taught myself how to play jazz. Of course, there was no jazz in Sykeston. There weren't any club.
Well, Sykeston's kind of known for country music, right?
Yeah, that's right. And, I hadn't got on to country music just yet.
Yeah.
But I was on to jazz from Dad's records, and I taught myself how to play bass by listening to Dave Brubeck's Jazz Goes to College, which is still one of my favorite albums. Around a little after that, some friends of mine decided that they wanted to put together a country music band, which we called Sour Mash.
In fact, we have a photo.
Yes, we sure do.
Let's bring up a photo. And you can talk as we bring up the photo. This is Sour Mash.
This is Sour Mash. It was a four-piece band. We played bluegrass and country. They needed a bass player. At this point, I didn't know anything about country music. I didn't listen to it on the radio. I learned it all from these guys. And
here we go.
I got it. Suddenly I realized this stuff is good. I like this stuff.
And you are the one in the one in the
middle. I'm the one in the back. I'm holding a fiddle because I would sometimes play. I played Jimmy Rogers' TV Blues with the band. And Chuck Hanna, our banjo player, is holding what was my electric bass. Ken Harbin, who is still alive in the middle, plays guitar. And then Greg Tanner was the regular fiddle player.
Right.
Well, I was, of course, the nerdiest imaginable kid in the universe. And these guys, you know, I was the smart kid, you know, aced the classes and played the violin. And these guys sort of made it their job to bring me out of my shell. And one of the ways that they did it was by introducing me to country music, which I fell deeply in love with. And still am to this day. There's not many kinds of music I don't like. I don't really like reggae. But beyond that, you know, all music is one to me. And country music is an important part of my world of music. And we had
a wonderful time. You are a walking encyclopedia when it comes to music.
Well, we used to gig around town. We played at pizza parlors and restaurants. And
here we go. Here's another.
This is our first radio broadcast. We played at the gymnasium of the school where my mother had gone when she was a girl. That was a fun night. We were on the radio. When I was a senior, we took the summer off and we actually went to Nashville, thinking, of course, that the world was waiting for us. It wasn't. But we did get to see the Grand Ole Opry in its old home, the Ryman Auditorium, the converted church. And by then, I knew that I would always love this music. But I also knew that classical music and jazz were equally important or more important to me. Classical, of course, I had played in the school system.
Right.
But I was eager once I went to college, and I went to college in a college called William Jewell, which is in a suburb of Kansas City. I was eager to find people I could play jazz with, so I wouldn't just be playing along with a record. Because I had listened to my father's records, the older musicians in Kansas City were surprised by this kid who knew all the old songs. You're seeing a picture of two of them, Harry Jenks, the pianist, and Hep Roller. Harry was the ballpark organist for the Kansas City Baseball Stadium. He was also an extraordinary musician who could play just like Art Tatum. I don't mean sort of like Art Tatum. I mean, if your eyes were closed, you'd think it was Tatum at the piano. But he never wanted to leave town. He was happy to play at the ballpark to teach the kids in the neighborhood. And he played at a Shakey's Pizza Parlor every Saturday night, which was where I met him. And he told me how to join the union and start gigging. And while I was in school, I began gigging on weekends. And we had a rather good big band at the school. And every year we brought in a famous jazz soloist to appear with us. Clark Terry came, Cat Anderson, Duke Ellington's high note man. And the man in the center of this picture with the cap on is Phil Woods, the great alto sax player, who most people know him because he is the alto sax player on Billy Joel's record of Just the Way You Are. But he was also one of the greatest beboppers in the history of jazz.
And how old are you here, Terry?
I would venture to say about 20. Okay. And I'm playing my little red Fender bass next to him. Yeah. And Phil said to me, you know, you have talent. You could very possibly make it as a session player on the West Coast. And I thought, yeah, is this what I want to do? Maybe. Because by then I was doing a lot of weekend gigging and enjoying it. But I realized that I was a good bass player, but I wasn't going to be a great bass player. One of the things about music is that you become very realistic about what you can do and what you can't do. I knew I had my limits, and I realized I was better at writing than I was at playing music. And this led to the great formative experience of my youth, the one that put me on the road I ended up with. You asked me once if I had a mentor. The mentor I had in college was a man named Wesley Forbes. He was the chairman of the William Jewell College Music Department. And he was very smart. And he saw that I liked to play, but by that time I was also writing for the college newspaper, and he'd obviously been talking to people about me. And he called me into his office, and he said, you know, Terry, you play music and you're a good writer. Have you ever thought about writing about music, that might be what you would want to do? And I hadn't. The idea had never occurred to me. Wes set it up for me to do an independent study with the man who was then the classical music critic at the Kansas City Star. And I ended up, after he died, and his successor took his job, and I became the second string classical music of the Kansas City Star while I was an undergraduate in college. And I noticed that they didn't have anybody covering jazz, and I told them I'd do that too. I know about jazz. And I became the first string jazz critic of the Kansas City Star when I was still 20, 21 years old. It was too young. You know, they say about doctors, they've got to kill a few people before they can really learn what they're doing. I killed a few people.
I just want to stop there for a second, because we kind of glossed over some earlier stuff, and we don't have to spend a lot of time on it.
Oh, no, of course.
I do want to show your other grandparent and the picture of your parents. But you're also an accomplished pianist, I understand.
Yes.
But you didn't talk about that.
Well, let's run us back to the relatives. And
okay, let's go back to just quickly. We don't have to talk a lot about it, but
no.
Your grandma Verona You said she. You describe her as city-fied, elegant wasp from Omaha.
Yes, and multiply married, and as a result, none of her husbands, including my paternal grandfather, I didn't know any of them. They played no role in my life. Verona did, though, and she terrified my mother. My mother. Remember what my mother is. She's a little girl from a dirt farm. And Verona, for some reason, she really took to her. And Verona gave my mother a coat of polish. And she could be a very frightening and difficult woman, but not in front of me. And she had no particular influence on me, except that it was in her apartment in Omaha that I first saw a copy of and read The New Yorker. So maybe that's a big thing.
Yeah. And then let's just show some pictures of mom and dad. I guess is Herbert or Bert. You said he was a hardware salesman, and your mom, yes. Evelyn, was a secretary.
This is when they were quite young. My father had served in World War II in the Army Air Forces over in the Philippines. And he came back to Sykeston, which is where his stepfather was running a gas company, and my mother was a secretary there, and they met and fell in love. And as you can see, I had quite an attractive mother. She was the Cotton Carnival Queen one year. That was our big celebration down in Southeast Missouri. Cotton and watermelon were our cash crops. And Dad was a very handsome man. He was unsure of himself. His mother had made him that way. But he was wildly, madly devoted to my mother. And they were great parents. They were parents where you never doubted that they loved you. And I've gotten old enough to know how important that is and how uncommon it is for many people.
I think we got a couple more photos here.
We have a photo of them in later life sitting on it's not a porch swing because it's in the background. It's in the backyard, but that was what it was. And my mother, I took after her. I look like her. I was nothing like my father. He found me utterly befuddling.
welcome to my world.
Yeah, I think he was concerned that I might have might be playing on the wrong team, so to speak. He was quite relieved when he found out that I wasn't. He wanted me to be a lawyer. But I had a lot of musical talent, and my mother, thank heavens, was when it became clear that I was an unusually bright child and I had a lot of different kinds of talent, she was kind of thrown, and she went to the pediatrician who took care of me, and he said, "It'll be all right. Let him do what he wants. Make him do some regular guy stuff too, but don't force it on him. Mm-hmm. He may not be any good at it. I am left-handed, and so I am bad at all sports." But I went through a stretch playing Little League, which was nightmarish. I don't think I ever got a hit at bat. I was a Cub Scout. I was a Boy Scout. I did all those things. And I had friends, because it wasn't like everybody just pointed and stared at me. It was a small town. Your friends were in the neighborhood. And there are some of them I'm in touch with to this day. Nobody has a good time as a teenager. And I had my difficulties, as everybody else does. But by then, it was quite clear to me that I was going to have something to do with the arts. I was making music in every way that I could. I asked my parents to give me piano lessons, and they bought a piano, and I studied it with fair seriousness. I think we have a picture of me and my mother.
Yeah, I think there's a photo, Bruce, of him with your mom, but this is when you're older.
Yeah, this is a little later. But I also got interested in theater. We had... that's it. That's in what our living room used to look like. The bookshelf was full of Reader's Digest condensed books, and I was playing whatever she wanted me to play that day. But I got interested in theater because we had a high school drama club, and they came over to the junior high school gym and did a production of Blithe Spirit, which I thought was absolutely the coolest thing I ever saw. And when I got to high school, I joined the drama club, and I discovered that I was not a great actor. I was a useful actor. I was the guy they built the beard on to play the character parts. I was not capable of playing leads. And because there was nobody there to tell me that there are things you can do in theater other than act, it never occurred to me to pursue that as a career, even though I continued to do it in college, because it had been very different. But I played music, I did theater, I read every book in the library, and when I got to Kansas City, which is where I went to school, you know, I reached out, met the older musicians, started playing, and started gigging, and then I had the great conversation with Wes Forbis that put me on the track, but I still could not yet believe that one could be a writer for a living. When you come from a small town, where is your role model for a writer? It's a newspaper. You know, that's all you're going to see. That's all you're going to do. People don't write books, nothing like that. And so I was circling the airport. And we spent some time in Kansas City. And then I decided that I can't believe I did this. I really can't. I decided that I wanted to become a psychotherapist.
Yes.
And went back to school for 2 years at the University of Illinois at Champaign-Urbana to get the necessary undergraduate credits to start on the road to a master's degree in psychology. And part of that was that I spent a year working the graveyard shift on the county mental health center's crisis line. I was actually the person you talked to if you called in and wanted to kill yourself or you were pregnant or, you know, whatever people call in for. And I had a knack for this, and I think I could have been a competent therapist. But thank heavens, I had already started writing for magazines. And one of the magazines I was in touch with, Harper's Magazine, offered me an internship in New York.
This is around 1985, is that right?
Yeah, I was 29. So I'd been to New York twice as a visitor, but never spent any time there. And I was already doing a fair amount of professional writing, but I'd never been a professional editor. But I thought, I will never get another chance like this. I'd better take it. And so I moved to New York. And it was like putting the key in the correct hole for the first time.
Yeah.
Suddenly, everything began to make sense. I was a good editor.
Right.
I was good at working with writers. I opportunities to write professionally just fell on me like a ticker tape parade. And I never look back. I don't play music anymore. I miss it.
Yeah, I want to ask you that. So you played all these instruments and then you stopped.
Well,
why?
I played them well enough that it was not fun to not play them well. And once I stopped gigging, once I stopped having an opportunity to play every weekend, when I pick up a bass now, it feels like I have mittens on. And it's not really... And also, when you've been a jazz musician, it's really not fun to play by yourself. And so I just walked away from them. And it was the right thing to do, obviously, because my life took the shape that it should have. But I call myself a recovering musician. And... So I tell people I'm like an old drunk when I walk past the the bar. I know not to go in and have one, but sometimes my hands twitch a little.
So you don't even touch the piano?
No, I have an electric keyboard here, but it's really not easily accessible. And I just don't play anymore. I miss it, but not enough to do anything about it.
So from 85 to 87, you're an editor for Harper's Magazine.
Right. Started out as an intern, became an associate editor.
And then 87 to 93, you're editorial writer for the New York Daily News. Want to talk about those years?
Yeah. Harper's was not an ideal gig. And I knew I didn't want to stay there. But I didn't know what to do next. And somebody at the Reader's Digest actually got in touch with me and asked if I'd like to become an editor there, which back then was quite tempting because they still owned all the paintings that the Dwight Wallace had collected. And you got to have one for your office. You could have a Monet in your office. It was tempting. But they made it quite clear that it was a full-time editing job and that they would expect me not to write. And an older friend of mine in New York said, okay, you got to do something that's going to allow you to write if you're a writer. If you're going to be an editor, but otherwise don't take this job. By this time, I knew William F. Buckley Jr. Because I wrote for National Review. He actually wrote a column about me once, and I met him when I came to New York. And he was one of the nicest men in the world and also one of the great talent scouts of journalism. So he kept an eye on me, and I went to a dinner at his house, and I was seated next to his wife, Pat Buckley, the woman about whom Tom Wolfe coined the phrase social x-ray. And she was a scary lady, but she liked me. I don't have any idea why she liked me. She didn't intimidate me. And she said, what are you up to? And I said, well, I'm still at Harper's, and I don't really like it. And the Reader's Digest tried to hire me, but that's not right either. And she was taking all this in, and she talked to Bill. And the next day, Bill called me up and said, I understand you're interested in doing something else. And I said, well, yeah, Bill. And he said, well, let me call a couple of people. And the day after that, I got a call from the man whom I would say was my other professional mentor, Michael Pakenham, who was the editorial page editor of the New York Daily News. And he knew that Bill was a good talent scout, and he called him up and said, send me a kid. And so Michael called me, we had lunch, and I went to work there. And that was graduate school. Writing editorials for one of the biggest newspapers in the country.
Is that 1993?
Put the page together.
1993?
Say again.
Is it around 93?
Yeah, that sounds right.
Now, you're the classic music and dance critic of the New York Daily News. So how
that came a little later. Okay. I was working for Michael, writing editorials, and I was writing for everybody else, in a sense. I mean, I was writing book reviews for National Review, for the New York Times Book Review. And I made it clear to them, and this is an important thing about me, that I did not want to specialize. I had always been interested in all of the arts, and I didn't just want to write about music. I didn't just want to write about jazz. I wanted to write about whatever seemed interesting. And they bought it. They both bought it, and I was what we called a utility outfielder, somebody who could.
I was going to ask you about that because you said that
somebody who could write about whatever the editor wanted.
Okay.
And I became known. It's very easy to get typecast as a writer, but because of this, I became known as somebody who could write about all kinds of things, and Michael moved on from the paper, and I ended up becoming their classical music critic, and I had gotten interested in dance, and I started reviewing dance for them as well.
Yes, I was going to ask, how does a musician, author, suddenly become a dance critic? How does that happen?
It's not an uncommon transition. In my case, I had a come-to-Jesus moment, as we say down south. There was a documentary about George Balanchine on PBS. I had, at this point, not seen... I'd seen The Nutcracker, but that was like an isolated experience, not some... You didn't think, oh, there's more stuff like this. And this Balanchine documentary that PBS did, which had lengthy excerpts from a lot of his work, staggered me. And I thought, well, this is in New York, right? I should come and see them. And so I bought a ticket in the cheap seats, several miles up, to see New York City Ballet. And I was completely overwhelmed. I started going to dance performances two or three nights a week. If you do that, people who do that will notice you. And if you can write, they'll ask you if you want to write. And I started writing for a little magazine called The New Dance Review. And I taught myself by looking and seeing what I saw to be able to write intelligibly about dance. And I ended up, a little later, I was writing about classical music and jazz and dance for Time magazine in the last years when Time was a serious magazine that covered the arts.
So we'll get into later, you've written many biographies, and one was on Balanchine.
Yes.
And so he clearly had a huge impact on you in his dance.
It was tremendous. I mean, I saw, they did Concerto Barocco, which was one of his masterpieces, set to the Bach double violin concerto, a piece I had played as a violinist. And when you're a musician and you see a Balanchine ballet for the first time, it's as though the music is coming to physical life in front of you. You connect with it immediately. Mm-hmm. And I thought, who is this guy? And I read everything. He had died that year, so I didn't meet him. But I read everything I could get my hands on about him. And to skip ahead just a little later, I realized that I had needed a book at that moment that didn't exist, a short book about George Balanchine for people who had just seen his work for the first time. And so I wrote a book called All in the Dances, A Brief Life of George Balanchine, which is now on sale at New York City Ballet's bookshop and at ballet companies everywhere.
We got to give some plugs to all your books later, because you can get online, right?
That was how that happened. I mean, dance was the next to last art form that I connected with, the last one being the visual arts. But I am by now, I don't have a day job. The New York Daily News editorial page was a day job, but I was making my living purely as a freelancer, not having to go to the office. And I realized that I liked this very much. People were coming to me. For a couple of years, I wrote a monthly column for the Washington Post, a New York letter, which we called Second City, in which I wrote about all of the performing arts. This was all great. I needed some center to it. And I at this point, I had not written a long book, a book of any substance. And if you're a newspaper man, a journalist, you know about H.L. Mencken, who was maybe the greatest newspaper man of the century. And Mencken had a cache of secret papers that had been sealed.
The undiscovered.
They were locked up tight.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and they were opened, and they were quite shocking in some ways, because they reveal that what he thought of you wasn't always the way he behaved towards you in person. And it was quite clear that it was time immediately for somebody to start a biography for which these papers were primary source. And so I went back to Bill Buckley and I said, Bill, you got a foundation, right? Can you make me a grant where I can open an apartment in Baltimore and go down there regularly to work in the Mencken papers? And he said, yeah, I'd be glad to. So I leased an apartment in Baltimore and started going down there every couple of weeks, because all of Mencken's papers are at the Baltimore Public Library, the Enoch Pratt Free Library. And I did. That's also when I got my first laptop. So I could. I was the first person to bring a laptop into the making room. And I got into the closet of the making room because I was going to look at everything they had. And this was one of those old, tight, high closets with a 10-watt bulb. And I got a library ladder and got up to the top shelf, which clearly nobody had touched for decades because everything was covered with dust. And I found an unpublished manuscript of some consequence by Macon, which was uncatalogued. And so even before my biography came out, you know, I brought this manuscript to Alfred Knopf, who had been Macon's publishers, and prepared and edited it for publication. And then my own book came out. And I found the way to learn how to write a biography is to write one. And I found that I liked writing biographies and that I would want, I thought, I'm going to want to do more of this. And I put that kind of in a mental file. So the book, The Skeptic, came out, was very, very well received. I'm very proud of it. It's considered the standard biography.
But I want to ask you, Terry, he could be a very controversial character. Oh, and people people questioned his character and to be the anti-Semitic. And, you know, what did you learn about him that was a surprise to you?
Nothing shocked me because I knew a lot about him going in. I didn't have illusions about him. The extent of the anti-Semitism startled me. I knew he had had interesting, shall we say, ideas about Jews, but he also had close Jewish friends, including Alfred Knopf, his publisher. He had many of the same anti-Semitic prejudices that German Jews themselves have. Knopf had them, for example. People didn't like to talk about that. They didn't want to believe it was true. And I wanted to write it. I didn't want to write a book for fans. I wanted to write a book that really explained what kind of man Mencken was. And he was a difficult, ornery man. In some ways, he was quite lovable. He fell in love well into adulthood with a woman who had what he was told was a terminal disease, and he was told that she would probably die in a year or two. And he proposed to her in the hospital, and she lived for 5 years, and it was an idyllic marriage.
Yeah.
He's not a totally bad guy, but also not a totally good guy.
Yeah.
And that's a good person to write a biography.
I didn't know the good part. Let's go back a little bit and talk about your transition to the Wall Street Journal as your primary theater critic. How did that happen?
Well, I wrote about theater in my Washington Post column on occasion because I was writing about all of the arts. But I had never been a working drama critic, day-to-day cover shows. So I by this time had done a lot of book reviewing for the Journal and feature writing. And they were ramping up their arts coverage. And at the Journal, the critics are part of the editorial page department, and they report to the editorial page editor, who is Paul Jugot. Jugot called me and said, come down and have lunch with me. I'd like to talk to you about our arts coverage. So, okay, sure, fine. He's the boss. He's the boss. And the new arts editor was at that lunch, Eric Gibson. And we ate lunch for 30 minutes, and then they sprung it on me. They said, you know, we do not have a regular drama critic, and we think we'd like you to do this once a week. And I said, well, you know, I know something about theater. I did it in high school and college, but it's not my field. And they said, our guess is that theater is a field where a generalist can be right, somebody who knows a lot about a lot of the arts, and somebody who can also put theater in the larger world of art and culture. And I said, all right, we'll try it. Let's shake hands and we'll give it a try. And I wrote my very first review, which was I got to choose when I started and what the play was. It was David Ives's Polish Joke. I thought I love David Ives, and I wanted to start with something I knew I'd like. And within 3 weeks, it was just like, you know, when I first moved to New York and felt like I'd found the right keyhole, I realized that I was good at this and that I wanted to do it a lot. That maybe this was a vocation for me, having discovered it in the middle of my life. And I, you know, we didn't talk about it. I just kept on doing it and never stopped. And I have been doing it now for, I don't know, like 16, 17 years.
I thought it was close to 20. Now, yeah, Terry, it's been
getting up there.
It seems that it has been your mission. I don't know if it's of you or of the Wall Street Journal or of both, to bring exposure to the regional theater circuit.
Well, let me tell you how that happened. It was not my idea, again. Eric Gibson, my editor, called me up and said, you know, we are focus grouping the journal's arts coverage. And he said, what we are finding is that people find it too New York-centric. Might you be willing to do some out-of-town reviewing? And I said, okay, yeah, but I don't know anything about regional theater, so you've got to bear with me here. It may be a steep learning curve. And they said, fine. So it happens that my best friend lives in Chicago, and I visit her usually once a year. So I went out. Her name is Laura Demansky. She's one of my books is dedicated to her. And I went out, and I said, Laura, they want me to see some shows. You want to go see some shows? And I just got lucky. The first thing I saw was a production by Chicago Shakespeare of A Little Night Music.
Oh.
And the second thing I saw was a production by the Court Theater, which is the professional theater of the University of Chicago, of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. And both
of these...
You had
a good start.
Pardon?
You had a good start.
Well, both of these productions, the way I thought of it back then was, gee, these would be good enough to play in New York. And as I fanned out over the country, because the journal really liked this and wanted me to do more of it, I realized that that was unintentionally condescending and inappropriate, because the truth was that every major city in America, and some of the not so major ones, has theater that is as good as anything you can see in New York. Mm-hmm. This was a colossal discovery for me, and I ramped up my out-of-town coverage with the journal's enthusiastic support to the point where, at its peak, I usually review about 100 shows a year, and my brief with the journal is to review all Broadway openings and in between anything I want to do. And I, at one point, was reviewing 50 out-of-town shows a year. It was at first, what I did was, okay, I looked to see who won all the regional Tonys for theater. And then I started looking in the bios of people who impressed me when I went to regional productions and seeing where they had been, where they performed. And I started gradually to put together a list of companies that sounded interesting to me and started to work my way through it. And 2 or 3 years into this, I had figured out where the action is, what the important companies are, where they are. I developed a list of people I went to see every year without fail. Eventually, you know, Palm Beach Dramaworks became part of it.
Very fortunate.
The first theater company on that list was Writers Theater in Glencoe, which is a suburb of Chicago, and companies that I would come see every year or two. I also learned to tell, it's like you can smell it from a website, whether a company's any good or not. And I became willy-nilly an expert about American regional theater in between seeing musicals and Broadway openings and off-Broadway stuff. And by this time, I knew that I'd found the greatest job in the world and that I never wanted to do anything else. I love it. I just love it. And I'm not in any way blasé. You know, people do burn out from being critics. But I think because I started being a drama critic later in life than many people do, I still get excited every time the lights go down. It doesn't always last.
You miss it. How would you define your role as a theater critic?
Teacher. I try in everything I write. I assume that I have the knowledge of a specialist about theater, and I want to impart it to the reader, but not in a heavy-handed way. I want them to come away from that review knowing more than they did when they started and making them wish they could see the show. And I also think of it as a kind of project that if you read me for a year, you will come away with a real sense of what theater is like, not just in New York, but in America. And I have my private goal, my background goal, is I want to make other cities destination cities for theater, not just New York, which is the only one there is. The truth is there's just as much good theater in Chicago as there is in New York. There's just as much good theater in Washington, D.C., and South Florida taken as a whole. And my goal is for people to know that wherever they go, there's going to be something worth seeing and give them a sense of where it is and what it might be. So that's my project. I'm the theater tutor.
That's been clear, and it has had such a huge, huge impact. I mean, just on our organization alone, but all my colleagues that I speak to are so grateful for what you've done for the regional theater in this country. And so,
I also tried to be entertaining. I mean, not at anybody's expense. There are people who make fun in bad reviews. I don't like writing bad reviews. Generally speaking, I will not blitz an out-of-town company. If the show wasn't good enough, I just won't review it. Because I know I can do a lot of damage. I can't do any damage to a Broadway show. Mm-hmm. But I can do a devastating amount of damage to a show in, you know, Minneapolis. And I have learned to smell, I've used that word before, I've learned to smell what's good from a distance. Because I've been doing this enough, I know the companies, I know the directors. There are specific actors, regional actors, whose work I will come to see that are could, if they wanted to live in New York and have a major career, they could. But they'd rather have a civilized life in Chicago or West Palm Beach. But I really hate, I'll use this word, it's a little naughty, but it's appropriate. I don't like pissy critics, and I try my best not to be one.
Well, you
the
certainly
only people I will do that to are Hollywood people who decide they can make their debut on a stage on Broadway without any experience. They're fair game. And every once in a while, they'll be terrific. But sometimes they're not.
Yeah, I've seen that many
I'll
times.
I'll give it to them with both barrels.
How much work do you do any work in advance? Do you read the play, or do you just want it to be a completely fresh experience?
I want to see what the audience sees. I never read a new play in advance. I want it to come to me the way it is coming to everybody around me. But by now, I mean, I must have reviewed 1,000 shows. I mean, I couldn't count. If you're paying attention, you learn a lot. And I know now an enormous amount about theater. And I read a lot of theater criticism. That was something I did right from the beginning, was I decided to see, okay, who has done this well? Stark Young did it well. Brooks Atkinson did it well. Harold Klerman did it really well. And I've learned from that, and so I now have I could sit down and write a history of theater in America off the top of my head.
I think you probably will.
I don't know.
So when you sit down in the audience, what do you look for in a production?
Well, not to be bored.
Oh, there's
that's
that.
Really it. Harry Cohn, the guy who ran Columbia Pictures, he, whenever he screened Rushes, he would say, you know, if I start to squirm, I know something's wrong. And Herman Mankiewicz, the guy who wrote Citizen Kane and who was a quipster, he said, oh, imagine the whole world wired to Harry Cohn's ass. But the truth is, Harry Cohn was right. If I'm bored, something is wrong up there. And my job begins to be figure out what it is, what's wrong, who's making the mistake. It's typically the director. Actors are the great professionals of theater, and of course the design people. And you can,
you know, often, you're gonna get a hard
you can time. Often guess when direction is getting between you and the show. And if I'm not bored, I can tell within 5 to 10 minutes that I want to be there, that I'm excited. I have, in all my theater going, only had a radical change of mind at intermission, after intermission, once about a new play. And that was The Pillow Man. At the end of the intermission, I thought, what in hell is this? And at the end, I was stunned by how good it was. But I was truly befuddled at intermission.
How do you deal with Terry, if there's a particular play you just don't like? Do you go into with a fresh set of eyes? Do you give it a shot, or you just?
You mean a play I already know I don't like?
Pardon me?
Do you mean a play I already know I don't like?
Yeah. How can you fairly critique it if you know you don't like it, and it might be a great production? I mean,
this is the deal. You know, I'll go twice. But other than having to review Broadway openings, I choose what I see. And if I've decided that I just don't think a play that other people like or a playwright is any good, I won't cover them. There is one quite famous play that I hope never to see again as long as I live, and unfortunately, I'm sure I'll have to see it many times. That is Cat on a Hot Tin Roof.
Okay, let's talk about it.
Absolutely.
Why?
Unbearable.
And I have talked about this. What don't you like?
It's just a big, noisy, phony play where the emotions are exaggerated. Also, where Williams is not able to write frankly about homosexuality. He has to kind of, you know, put a coating of nonsense on top of it.
That's true.
But mainly it's an overwrite play. Tennessee Williams is a tricky playwright, and he wrote a lot of plays I don't much care for. He also wrote what I think is one of the two greatest American plays, The Glass Menagerie, and one of the top-ranking ones, A Streetcar Named Desire. But I have seen Cat gets done a lot because there are stars who want to do it. And once in a while, I'll see it, and there will be an incredible actor in it. I saw a Broadway production of it where Ned Beatty, who you don't get to see on stage very much, plays Big Daddy. And he just blew me into the balcony. And that's who I wrote about in the review. But generally speaking, and there are playwrights, and I would rather not say who they are, younger playwrights whose work I do not like. I know I don't like it. We're not on the wavelength. I don't review them.
So let's talk about some of the plays and playwrights that you think are underrated.
Well, I don't know anybody's. The playwrights I admire most are not underrated. People know how good they are. Lynn Nottage, to me, and Kenneth Lonergan are the two great American playwrights.
I love them both. They're both two of the best contemporary playwrights for sure.
And there's a bunch of younger people, all women, coming up. Katori Hall, who I saw a play of hers I did not like, was my first exposure to her, the play by Martin Luther King. And a friend of mine said, no, give her another chance. And I did, because I know good advice when I hear it. And the second play of hers I saw, again, blew me out of the theater. And I have reviewed with the utmost admiration everything of hers I've seen since then.
You're the one that told me, long before she was a name, to watch Lynn Nottage. It was you, years ago.
I saw, the first play of hers I saw was Intimate Apparel.
Oh, okay.
I didn't know who she was. And I thought, boy, this is a really good play. Who is this? And I thought, I'll seek out something else by her. And Baltimore Center Stage was doing Crumbs from the Table of Joy.
Hillary and I
went down there.
I just recently exposed myself to that play. I had never read it. It's a beautiful, beautiful memory play.
It doesn't get done much, but I think it's like a black glass menagerie. And you know, when you have two home runs with me, I follow you. I should mention Amy Herzog is one of my favorite under 50 playwrights. I think she really has the root of the matter in her, and I've liked everything of hers I've seen. I've been deeply moved by it. Our friends on the other side of the ocean, of course, we all love Tom Stoppard, but Connor McPherson and Martin McDonagh are the great living playwrights. And when he was alive, I thought that Brian Friel was the greatest English-speaking playwright in the world. I admired him completely and without reserve. And he became a playwright because he isn't done in the United States as much as he should be, that I would go elsewhere to seek out his work. I saw Dancing at Luna's Florida Rep on that first trip down to Florida. And that was the second play by him I saw. My first one was the Irish Repertory Theater in New York, did Philadelphia, Here I Come. And again, if the first play you see is great, you will probably feel that way about more of them. If the first place you see is not great, it may be a fluke. So I always try to keep that in mind. It would have thrown me off the track with Katori Hall if I hadn't given her another chance.
I got two questions that kind of go hand in hand. Prior to the pandemic, and you've been reviewing almost two decades on Broadway, nearly.
Yeah.
What significant changes had you seen in Broadway over the last two decades? And the second part of that question is, post-pandemic, what do you see changing?
Well, the big change in Broadway since I came to New York is that it has become completely tourist-driven. When we were younger, back in the days of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, there were plays that everybody in New York felt that they had to see, water cooler plays. The last one I can remember is Six Degrees of Separation.
Great play.
Well, actually, Tom Stoppard's The Coast of Utopia was a water cooler play. But Broadway became too expensive for people just to go routinely. And at the same time, musicals started having much longer runs. And suddenly there were fewer shows on Broadway, and tourists wanted to see a musical while they were in town. This changed the entire ecology of Broadway. And I think the change has been entirely unhealthy. It's priced ordinary people out of the theater going market. It has, to priced serious theater out of the Broadway market. How many times a year do you see a great revival or a new play of the first rank on Broadway? Damn rarely. No, it's all about the musicals. And look, I'm not snobbish about musicals. A good musical to me is just heaven. A show like The Band's Visit is as good as anything I've seen in the last 10 years. But I really don't like what I call commodity musicals, which are musicals adapted from a hit movie that they're repurposing the show for the purposes of making more money about it. Mm-hmm. The one I always cite is Legally Blonde. The fact that a show called Legally Blonde could be turned into a musical is a sinful development on Broadway. Mm-hmm. So that's the big change on Broadway. The pandemic, of course, stopped us all dead. The last show, coincidentally, that I saw in a theater was Katori Hall's The Hot Wing King, a wonderful, wonderful play. And then the door slammed. None of us really thought this was going to happen. And I immediately had to retrofit my column so I'd have a job. And I didn't miss a beat. I thought, okay, I think we're going to have theaters that are going to be showing webcasts of their work. And I'm going to start using my column to write about those, just like I wrote about regional theater. And you had a lot of companies that they got the dress rehearsal or the first performance of their last production before the pandemic started. They got it videoed, or they had really good archival tapes. And I started tracking these. I put a notice up on Twitter, which I still do, saying, I review theatrical webcasts. Get in touch with me directly if you want me to review your show. Some of them were by companies with whose work I was quite familiar. Several of them have been companies that I'd never seen or heard of. But this kept me going for a couple of months. And meanwhile, all of the theater companies are figuring, well, what are we going to do? You know, they don't know how long the pandemic's going to last. But suddenly they have been cut off from their audiences, from their patrons. And the smart ones figured out that they needed to get online content. Not just, I mean, this what we're doing, this is a good thing. I think this is going to be worth watching. But if it's all somebody does, it's not going to be enough. They need to get shows online. And there are different ways to do that. The Irish Repertory Theater, which is
You've been talking a lot about them.
Yeah, technical quality. Mm-hmm. They have figured out how to green screen actors on different continents into the same production, superimposing them over a high-def photograph of a scenic design, and create the illusion that they're in the same room together. It is absolutely uncanny. And I've been yelling about that in the Wall Street Journal and telling people when I talk to them on the phone, look, you want to see how to do it? Look at this. So the word is starting to spread, and people who were knocked off their pins by the pandemic are now starting to realize it's not going to go away. You're not going to be able to start performances again in December or January. If you want to be active, you have to make online theater of some kind, readings, staged performances without an audience, whatever. You have to make it a part of what you do. Because I believe that after the pandemic, and it's going to be a long time before we can say those words.
But also there's a whole new market online, and we're learning, we're really developing an audience because people are watching this across the country. We've gotten donations from overseas. So once we are even back in the building, we are going to have a very strong online presence.
And it means that instead of you're having to take my word for it when I go to West Palm or to Chicago and say, this is great, mm-hmm. that you'll be able to see for yourself. It will de-regionalize regional theater, and that will be a hugely important change in the ecology of American theater. And more companies are figuring this out, one by one, but with greater numbers. I've got a theater webcast scheduled to the end of the year now. And I'm actually having to pick and choose, and I was afraid that would never happen, but it has happened now.
I think I shared with you too that, you know, a vaccine's not going to make the virus go away.
No.
And I have a primarily senior-based audience, so we have to come up with alternatives, and I've already come to terms with all of our productions in the future will have to be professionally filmed.
Yeah.
And we're going to have a live subscription price if you come to the theater, and we're going to have an at-home subscription so you can watch it via protected link at home. you have to have that option because seniors are going to be reluctant to come back to the theater.
I won't blame them a bit for it. And meanwhile, Broadway may never reopen in recognizable form.
How the economics can't work. They're like
no, the houses are designed in such a way as not to permit social distancing. Right. And there's not going to be the kind. And remember that Broadway has become tourist-driven, and they're not going to be tourists. And even when people start coming back to New York, they're not going to want to go to the theater until we have herd immunity from the vaccine, and that's 2 to 4 years down the line. Right. So if regional companies now have an opportunity that they must seize to innovate from the ground up instead of waiting for Broadway to set the tone and do it, they need to do it themselves. And I am seeing signs with what you guys are doing, what other companies are doing, what the Irish Rep is doing, that they understand this and they're prepared to innovate. And I think that's great. And I intend to continue covering online theater in exactly the same way once we have it that I cover live theater.
Now,
I think it's going to be a major part of American theater.
I wasn't planning to talk about this, but there's a lot of tension with all the unions and the SAG versus equity and a lot of controversy. Are you going to use your position to influence this industry?
I don't know whether I can, but I'm going to try. I plan to write in the journal in a few weeks about the union jurisdiction issue and how it is affecting streaming video. No need to go into detail here, but Actors Equity is and has always been highly resistant to streaming video. And they're either going to change their approach or they're going to cease to exist because everybody will go with SAG after.
Well, I want to point out, and I think you and I have talked about this before, the big issue with both unions is they're not talking to the producers, the artistic directors and the managing directors. They're not hearing our voice. And so I think it would behoove to get the voice of regional producers out into the world because we are being misrepresented by these unions about what
our motives are. That's what I'm going to try to do. Unions are what they are. Unions exist not to give up hard-won territory. But when the world changes, you have to change the way you think about the world. And they need to do that. And I think SAG-AFTRA is more likely to make this conceptual jump than Actors Equity. But we'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Yeah. Let's because, of course, I knew with you time was going to fly, and I didn't even have to be here. I should have just introduced you and let you talk for the rest of the night.
Just wind me up.
But you are quite the biographer.
Yes.
You've written many and we've already talked about the Mencken and City Limits, Memories of a Small Town Boy, which was published in 1991. We talk about the Balanchine book. But I'm kind of curious, you're kind of the leading authority on Duke Ellington and Louis Armstrong.
And it wasn't something I expected. It was suggested to me that I write an Armstrong biography by my agents and a publisher. But as soon as they said it, I thought, yeah, right, I'll do that. I think I was actually on the book tour for Mencken, and my first stop was in Washington. It was like an arrow hit me in the forehead, and I thought, Louis Armstrong, sure. I had by this time discovered from writing the Mencken book that I like writing biographies. I can't write a novel, but a biography has something in common with a novel, except it's all got to be true. And so I wrote Pops. After that, I wrote Duke. And I kind of got sidetracked because I wrote a play, which we'll talk about later. But I hope to write maybe one more full-scale primary source biography in my life.
So it was for Pops, the Louis Armstrong, what was your primary source of research?
Well, of course, I looked at everything.
But and I want you to talk about the tapes as well.
Yeah, no, I will.
Yeah.
Armstrong was a pack rat. He saved everything, and it became part of the a center devoted to his private papers. His house has been preserved and belongs to the city of New York now. He was one of the very first people to own a tape recorder after World War II. Bing Crosby was the one who told him about it. Crosby was the first guy to do recorded radio. And Armstrong got his hands on a tape recorder and he thought, oh boy, what a great toy. And then he went a step farther and he started using it to record his memories, conversations, dinner parties, getting high in the dressing room with friends. And he saved all of these private recordings. So between that and his scrapbooks, which are copious, you had an enormous amount of primary source material to do an Armstrong book. But everybody assumed that the tapes, which were not conserved, they were left, you know, in the attic of the Armstrong house, would not be playable. They were. And the curators of the Armstrong House Museum transferred them to compact discs and did a finding aid, indexed them. And, you know, I didn't discover them. Everybody knew that Lewis had done these tapes. But I was the first person to go to work on a book about him after they were made available to researchers. And it was priceless. It was absolutely priceless. I mean, I found out things that I wouldn't have known. But because I'm not old enough to have known Louis Armstrong, I just felt like they put me on the inside of his life. I mean, there's a wonderful tape. Whenever I had visitors when I was working on this book, I'd always play this for them. And he's in a hotel room somewhere, I don't know, Tierra del Fuego. And he's trying to get his wife into bed. And it's pretty late, and she's really not interested in this. And so she's discouraging him, and he says, well, honey, you know, we got to keep that horn percolating. And then she sees that the tape recorder is on. And she says, Lewis, you turned that goddamn thing off. And he says, I can't do it, man. This is for history. Well, he saved it. Along with hundreds and hundreds of other reels of tape that make it possible for someone who didn't know Armstrong, never met him, to feel as though I did, and they were priceless. I could have written a book without them, but it would have been a different book.
What were the aspects of his life that you didn't know about that really just had a big impact on you?
Again, as with Mencken, I knew a lot about him, but one thing that you don't know until you really go into it is that he had a short temper. He would just suddenly explode, and then it would be gone. But he would go fly into these red rages, and then he'd forget them a minute or two later. That surprised me quite a lot. I was surprised by one of the things that the Armstrong Archive has also done. His tape collection also contains his record collection, which he taped off so he could take it on the road. And they did a finding aid for that. And he was interested in every kind of music there is. Jazz, classical, country music. Completely improbable things. He actually had a tape of Charles Laughton, Charles Boyer, Agnes Moorehead, and Cedric Hardwick doing Shaw's Don Juan in Hell. What is this? Why is this there? But it is there, and we know that it's there. And I learned so much about him from looking at what he listened to. Mm-hmm. I learned that he was an extremely talented visual artist. He did collages. All of the reel-to-reel boxes that contain his tapes, he did homemade Scotch tape collages on them. And it was a hobby for him, but he had real talent this way. He was a genius. He would never have said that, wouldn't have let you said it. But very often, genius manifests itself through multiple paths, and it did with him.
So let's talk a little bit with Louis Armstrong. You know, the mob was deeply in control of his life, and how racism impacted his career and his life, and also with Duke Ellington.
Well, Armstrong, of course, grew up in New Orleans. in the black prostitution district of New Orleans. And when he came north of Chicago, he came to the not unreasonable conclusion that in order to make his way in the world, he would need a white manager. And he got Joe Glazer, who had been connected with the Capone mob. And Glazer started a management firm, which was quite mobbed up, but they never talked about it. And this gave Armstrong insulation, protection from the problems that could hit a black artist out in the world without a really strong figure protecting him. And he came to see Joe Glazer as a father figure. You know, Armstrong's real life father was no part of his life. He had contempt for him. He was always in search for father figures, and Joe Glazer became the one that last, the least fatherly of men. But so Armstrong, you know, Glazer got him out of trouble when people were trying to shake him down. You knew that he had protection from the Capone mob. Ellington actually had Glazer as a manager for part of his career. And he also understood that in order to work in the white world, to play for white audiences, he needed to have a white manager who could protect him, who could insulate him from trouble. But both of these guys, this was just the reality for a black artist in the 30s, 40s.
Ultimately, at the end, did Glazer took advantage of him?
Well, he did and he didn't. The thing was that Glazer did not have control over his own assets, let's put it that way.
Okay.
And Armstrong had always felt, Glazer predeceased Armstrong, and Armstrong had always felt that he had assumed that Glazer would leave him stock in the management company that Glazer had started, Associated Booking, because, you know, he built it on Louis Armstrong. And he could not do that because he didn't own it. And Armstrong was deeply shocked when he found out that all Glazer had left him was some publishing rights, and it turned out later on quite a bit of money. Eventually, he understood that this was not something Glazer could have done anything about, you know, and he was a forgiving man. But when he first found out about it, he felt betrayed. This is an interesting thing to know about somebody like Armstrong. And I discuss it at length in Pops. And when I came to write a play about him, which we'll talk more about in a minute, you know, I realized that it would be a very important thing to put in play.
So let's talk about the inspiration to become a playwright and to take Louis as your first subject matter as a playwright. How did this all happen?
Well, I got married to Hillary Dyson, about whom we'll talk more later. And Hillary she thought anything I did was great, but she also thought I could do more than I thought I could. And she started out trying to get me to write a novel. And I said, honey, I've tried this. I don't have that talent. And she said, well, there's more to you than what you were doing. And one of my best friends is a very important classical composer, Paul Moravec, Pulitzer Prize winner. And Paul and I had talked casually about writing an opera together, but you don't write an opera unless somebody's paying you for it. You know, you don't do it on spec. Well, he won the Pulitzer, and I became the Wall Street Journal's drama critic. And, you know, our profiles increased. And Santa Fe Opera approached him and said, we have a commissioning grant. Would you be interested in writing an opera for us? So he said, let me get back to you. I'm up in Connecticut at Hillary's place, and he sends me an email is telling me this. And Hillary would always remember how she heard shouting from the back of the house because I absolutely started yelling. And I wrote him back immediately and said, go read a short story by Somerset Maugham called The Letter, which has been turned into a play. That's an opera. And we turned it into an opera. That was the first time I ever wrote anything for the theater. It was commissioned by Santa Fe Opera. They produced it. Ruth Bader Ginsburg was at the premiere. She was a great fan of Santa Fe Opera.
But haven't you also, have you collaborated with him a few other times as well?
No, this was the first time. I'd written about it.
But after that, I just thought.
After that, yeah, we wrote two more one-act operas and a cantata, I guess you would say. But The Letter was the first time I ever tried to write anything for the stage. This was a busy year. It was also the year that Pops came out and that I went on the book tour for it. I have no idea how I got through the summer and fall of that year. So it was a blur. The opera was very successful. I came back to New York, kind of stunned. And a guy whose name I didn't know sent me an email saying, I read your book. I think there's a play in it. And I thought, and I looked up his name, and it turned out he had been one of the producers of Jelly's Last Jam. So I called him, and I said, are you serious about this? And he said, well, I think there's something there. And I said, well, let me think about it. In the end, he couldn't work on it, but he planted the seed. And there was a photograph reproduced in Pops of Armstrong toward the end of his life, sitting in a chair in his dressing room in Las Vegas, looking absolutely exhausted. And my eye fell on this photograph, and suddenly the idea for a play about Armstrong came to me. I was doing an internship at Rollins College a month or two later, and I wrote it there. It came out very quickly, too quickly. I didn't trust any part of it to be any good. So by then, I had friends in the theater business that I could trust to tell me the truth. You know, critic can't always trust people to tell them the truth.
I was one of them. I saw an early draft of it. Yeah.
But people I trusted, I showed it to. They all said the same thing, which this is very promising. It's not soup yet, but you can make this into a play. So when I came back to Rollins the following year for my presentation, they hired an actor named Dennis Neal, who then was based in Orlando. He worked at Mad Cow Theater. And we did a workshop production of the play, the first half of it, I think, which I staged, not knowing any better. And at that point, he and his producing partner optioned it for me for a year. And they did a production of an early version of the play that fall at Orlando Shakespeare. And it was very different. It was different in many important ways from the play that ultimately emerged. But from that experience, I realized, okay, this is a play. I can make this work. And I started to show it around more widely. Shakespeare and Company at Lenox got a look at it, and they said, we'd like to do this, and we'd like to ask John Douglas Thompson to act.
I was there on your opening night there.
Yeah, and I said, okay, how high?
He was phenomenal, classical.
And then I also showed it to Gordon Edelstein, who then was running Longworth Theater. He said, I'd like to do this. And I said, well, they're doing it at Shakespeare and Company. And suddenly I become a businessman. I said, why don't you guys do a co-pro and you can direct the production? So that's what happened. We opened it at Lenox, and then it started. It was very, very successful.
John was incredible. We have some photos, and then we'd go to the Wilma after that.
Yeah.
So we're going to bring up some photos when Bruce is ready.
It was tricky for John. John had... Well, this is the original production team. That's Gordon Edelstein, you know me, and John Douglas Thompson in the rehearsal room. John had never done any comedy at all. And Gordon and I were both smart enough not to worry about that. You know, we just told him to play it straight. So he did it at Shakespeare and Company. This is the lobby of Shakespeare and Company. He did it there. And of course, from the very first line, the first line of Satchel and Company is a laugh line, or Satchel and Water was a laugh line. And the audience exploded. And you could see him resetting up there. He wasn't expecting this. And by the end of the evening, he knew that he liked it when people laughed. And the ovation we received was stupendous.
I know. I was there that night, and it was just a wonderful night of theater.
It was just astonishing.
People jumped to their feet even before the lights went out.
Yeah. So the Wilma asked to take the production for a week, and then it went to, I think it went to Longworth first, and then the Wilma. And then Gordon put together a commercial production of it that ran off Broadway.
The West End?
At the West Side Theater.
Yeah.
And it was successful there, too. And it was amazing. This is Hillary and me in front
of... Well, also you know, there's, of course, significant challenges for a one-character play. That, you know, really there's no antagonist or protagonist. They're just kind of talking to the audience. But in this, the genius behind it is the tape recorder became a second character.
Right, and that the same actor plays Armstrong, and then he crosses a racial line to play Joe Glazer. That's really the magic trick. And it was Gordon who told me it's got to be in one act. You can't have an intermission. It had an intermission in Orlando. He said, you can't sustain interest across
the nation. I remember when I went to that opening night, and I went up to you that night, and I said, I want to produce it at Dramaworks.
Yes, you did. And I thought, oh, yeah, right. But
I took you up on it. But
pretty
I also,
soon everybody wanted to do it. It was just astonishing.
It was a great success, but I also decided that I was going to have you direct it with me kind of watching over, because you've expressed interest in this. But you and I had to come to terms with the fact that if you were going to review us now, it was going to be a conflict of interest. So you and I had to come to terms with the fact that if you're going to work with me, you can no longer review shows at Palm Beach Dramaworks.
Well, the Journal and I had already started dealing with that when I did the letter, and we realized that if I was going to continue to work in the theater, there would have to be some sort of policy. Right. And we developed one because I didn't think it would be fair to black people out permanently because they wanted to do the play, that there would have to be a period of blackout after their last production, and then I reviewed them again.
I tell you what, you cannot review me this year and next year. How's that?
Okay.
Okay.
Well, the thing is that the play got done at many of my first string out of town theater companies.
When is there
in Chicago, for example? And but it was your idea, and we had Barry Shabaka Henley did it in Chicago, and then here.
And he did it here.
But it was your idea for me to direct, and I had enjoyed staging the workshop, but I had not thought in terms of directing until I got into the rehearsal room with Gordon, and I started asking him, how do you do this? What are you doing? And the seed was planted, and I thought, you know, maybe I could do this. And then I was present for all of Charlie Newell's rehearsals with Shabaka at the Court, and I essentially functioned as something not unlike an assistant director for him. And Charlie said, look, you know, I think you can direct. You ought to be thinking about this.
I went through a couple of more photos here. But I also want to talk, when you were here, I'd also just directed a production of Picnic. And I was in my research, I had read the biography on William Inge. And I learned some interesting information about the relationship between William Inge and Tennessee Williams, and Inge became a playwright because he drove to Chicago to attend the opening of the Glass Menagerie. And well,
let's not get to that just yet.
Okay, go ahead.
I want to talk a little about how I ended up directing this play.
Okay, go ahead. I'm just going to leave, ladies and gentlemen. Just go ahead.
I was open to the idea, but you know, you don't just say I want to direct a play, or you don't if you got any sense. And you and Sue Ellen and I, as I remember it, were having a bite to eat. I was there reviewing a show, probably, and. Yep. It was a bite to eat at one of the street places next door to the theater.
The Panettiere, yep.
And you broached the idea to me. You said, can you direct this? Would you be interested in directing this? And I'm not sure what I said, but what I was thinking, again, I'll be perfectly candid, was, holy shit, I've got to say yes to this. I have to say yes. I may never get another chance. And so I took the deepest of breaths and said yes. And... Then you were very kind. You said, look, we won't let you drown. We'll make sure you're afloat, but I think you can do this. So Hillary and I had more stops in Florida, and we were, I think, on Siesta Key, and we were watching a documentary about Mike Nichols. And Nichols was telling the story of how he became a director. By that time, was very famous for having his comedy duo with Elaine May. And St. Saber asked him to direct Neil Simon's second play, Barefoot in the Park, although he had no experience with it. And Nichols, he's telling this story in the documentary. He says he got into the rehearsal room and he sits down and looks around. And he suddenly thinks to himself, you know, everything I've ever done has prepared me for this. I know how to do this. This will be fine. And I looked at Hillary and I said, honey, I'm not Mike Nichols. And I can tell you this. I said, I think that's what can happen to me. And it was. I got down to Florida a few months later, went into your rehearsal space with Shabaka, with whom I had worked extensively on the Chicago production. And I just knew within 5 minutes, I know how to do this. This is going to work. It's going to be fun. And it was the most fun I've ever had in my life. And I got a second chance to stage the play at the Alley Theater when circumstances caused them to suddenly be without a director at the last minute. And and it was just as much fun the second time. And now my dream is to direct a play, not by me, but...
You say you want to do Come Back Little Sheba.
I'd like to do Come Back Little Sheba. Yeah. And there's a small play. I didn't tell you about this when we were discussing this Dramalogue. It's Seamus Heaney's English version for, I think, a three-man cast of Sophocles' Philoctetes. It's called The Cure at Troy. And I realized I would like to do an all-black production of this and set it on the street. So these ideas went into my pocket because I, you know, other things happened in my life and I couldn't continue directing. But your giving me the chance to direct Satchmo was an absolutely life-changing moment. And I was 60 years old. I made my debut as a stage director at the age of 60. Most people don't have a big thing change for them that late in life, but right. I did.
And when you were here, we got extremely close. You're now one of my dear friends, and there was significant trust. And I had this idea that I couldn't get out of my head, a story that had never been told about the relationship between Billy Inge and Tennessee, say Billy Inge like he's my friend, William Inge, and Tennessee Williams. And, you know, Inge had gone to Chicago to see the opening of Glass Menagerie. It changed his life. He became a playwright in later years when Tennessee Williams had all his success on Broadway, and then there was a decline in his career. It was at the time Inge was rising to popularity. He had like 5 shows running at once in New York. And I imagine the complications of that relationship. And of course, Tennessee Williams was very open about his sexuality, and William Inge tried to conceal it.
Yeah, tight as an apple skin.
Yeah, and I just couldn't get this idea of a play out of my head, and I talked to you about it.
We had lunch, and of course, by this time, I have a serious interest in Inge as a playwright, and I knew about the first meeting that he had gone. He had interviewed Williams in St. Louis, and then went up to see the Glass Menagerie. He had never known that you could make a play out of your life. That was the key. That was where the coin dropped. And so you told me this idea, and I said, you know, Bill, there is a play here. I'm not sure what it is, but there is a play here. And I was flying back up to New York, I think, the next day.
Yes, it was.
So I got on a plane, and the coin dropped, and I pulled out my laptop and started making notes. I think I may have called you from the runway.
You did. You called me as soon as you landed, even before they told you to turn.
Because I had to come back to Florida again. I was just going up to, I think I was going up to review Hamilton. But I called you and I said, I know what the play is. And that was the play that eventually became Billy and Me. The basic concept of it. It's your idea planted the seed. I figured out where the conflict was between the two men, how it would work out, roughly how it should be structured. And we then spent the next few months writing plays as a process of rewriting. And
we did a lot of that.
We put Billy and Me through innumerable drafts and talked it through line by line.
We talked for a year. We were talking every week.
Yeah.
Going through the script. I would even be acting out scenes for you over the phone. Bruce, I'm going to skip over the video teaser because we're running really late, but I do want to show some photos from the production. Here, yeah, Nick Richburg, when he's playing
Williams.
At the top of the play.
And Tom Wall, this is still Nick. That was our little joke, was to put Williams' memoirs on the stage.
Yes.
And Tom Wall, who actually looks a bit like Inge.
He does.
And the two of them, their chemistry was incredible. And it was really a joy, this
Virgin
play. It was good. We did a good job. It hasn't been done elsewhere. I hope it will have a life beyond the first production. Not all plays do. But it tells us an amazing story of how people become artists and how they come to terms with themselves, or in Inge's case, don't.
This is in Inge's apartment. Want to talk about that artwork now?
Yes. William Inge, of course, made an enormous amount of money and was interested in modern art.
And this is, he would lived in one Sutton Place.
Yeah, and he bought a painting by Willem de Kooning. And left it to the Nelson Atkins Art Gallery in Kansas City. That is where it hangs.
Isn't this a good fake, though?
It's a perfect fake. I think if memory serves, it is a bit larger than the original, but it is almost indistinguishable from it.
Yeah, Rebecca Pankos painted that.
Yeah, the painting can't travel. It's too fragile. So. Yeah. But I knew that if we could, that I would like to have that painting be a major set piece for this thing. That was a really well-designed production. Everything about it just clicked together well.
Yeah.
Those two guys, they're real actors. That was a good show.
I wish we had time to talk more about the play development process, but we were big time into overtime here. But I want to ask, what do you like most about directing?
That's interesting. Back when you developed photographs, you know, you put them in different chemicals, and they started to come to shape. The image would come in clear. I love the process of taking a script and actors, letting them do what they want to do, what works for them, and shaping that until and to try to find the arc of each scene and its point, and seeing it come to life. And I had, before I directed, I talked to you and a lot of other directors, and I read, there are a couple of good books about directing, about how to behave in the rehearsal room. And I had seen Charlie Newell, who is incredibly effective in a rehearsal room, who was a very nice man. And I knew that you didn't have to be a jerk to be a director, that you should be the opposite of that. You need to be kind and supportive. You need to remember that actors are doing something difficult and frightening. And you need to make sure that, that what they do is appreciated by you.
And art is collaborative.
Yes, and it came naturally to me. I don't quite see how, but then I'd seen a lot of plays, some of which were directed well and some of which weren't. And I had, by that time, I had seen up close two good directors work, Gordon Ellstein and Charlie Newell. I hadn't seen you in the rehearsal hall yet. And I internalized all of this stuff. So when I found myself in a rehearsal room, like I said, watching the Mike Nichols show, I knew what to do, and it came very easily to me. And every day was a joy. I just, you know, I'd have rehearsed an hour longer if I could have. Every day was pure pleasure. There is nothing more fun than going into a dingy rehearsal room with a good actor or a good group of actors who are eager to make something happening. And roll your sleeves up and go to work. It's the biggest thrill in the world. And then I like everything about it. Hell, I like tech. That always makes people laugh. I love lighting the show.
I even love now all the things I used to hate.
Yeah.
Because I miss it so much. Not that I really hated any aspect of the theater, but man, things I used to complain about, I would give my arm leg to do it again.
Gordon couldn't believe that I wanted to sit through the tech rehearsals. He said, it's like watching paint dry. And I said, I want to see it.
Yeah.
And I learned from it.
As we wrap this up, and soon I want to get to a handful of Q&As with the audience who will come on live to ask you some questions. I just want to touch upon, I know it's a difficult subject, you know, the love of your life and Hillary. We lost her recently. You and she were best friends. I mean, also, here she is.
And we fell in love at first sight.
And also a good friend of mine. And
yes, she loved Florida. She loved West Palm. She loved you guys in this company. And even when her health was bad enough that she shouldn't have come down, she actually came down to see the opening night of my production of Satchmo. And that was taken in the intermission. That's my brother on the left.
David.
His wife, my niece, his daughter. Hillary was utterly exhausted. I'm sure she looks pale, but there was no way that she was going to miss this, God bless her, and there was no way I could have told her not to come.
So on the far left is David, and his wife Kathy is to the far right, and I've met them both a couple of times, lovely people. But you brought a lot of national attention to the issue of organ transplant.
Yes, Hillary had a very rare disease called primary pulmonary hypertension, for which ultimately the only cure is a double lung transplant. She was on the transplant list for 7 years, and she was unusually short and had a tricky blood type for transplant A positive. And as a result, we didn't get donor offers. And also, she was so strong, you really have to be sick enough that they're willing to transplant you, that they'll move you up in priority. So we did everything together for as long as she could. Because she couldn't work because of her illness, so she would travel with me, and we went everywhere. You know, spent the night in Frank Lloyd Wright houses, and you know, drove up Highway 1 in California. This is us at our wedding breakfast. Everything we did together. The last 2 years of her life, she started to fail, and a year before she died, it became clear that she was really starting to lose altitude. And the good part of that was that it moved her up the transplant my priority list. And she began to get what are called donor offers. But it has to be a double lung transplant. So you got to get two good lungs. And we had three dry runs where they call you usually in the middle of the night and then said it was no go a few hours later.
Yeah, but you talked to me so often about, you know, all the red tape and you were so frustrated and angry and, you know, it depended on what your address was, what state you lived in, you know, and it's just, you know, and you said in New York City, there's a shortage of organs because...
There's a shortage everywhere, but it's especially bad in New York. Lots of people just don't want to donate organs, and it's quite bad in New York, in the New York area, the transplant region. So Hillary's condition deteriorated so much that last December, I think, you know, Christmas Eve, I actually think it was, she had previously had to be airlifted from our place in Connecticut to New York and never went back there. And she had quite a desperate crisis. We had to call an ambulance. She spent 7 hours waiting to get into the ICU. And they told her, you will not leave this hospital until you get a transplant. That was a tough thing to hear. So she spent January there. The hospital is a mile from where we live. I picked this apartment so that we'd be that close. And, you know, we waited. We basically lost hope.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, you know, become organ donors. It's an easy thing to do. And you say, and you brought a lot of a national attention to this issue.
I really did because she got a donor offer in the ICU. We got the call, what we call the big call, while I was there visiting her. And they transplanted her the next day, but she did not recover. She was simply too ill. She had waited too long. She lived for 3 weeks, and then she died.
I know this is a hard topic, so I want to kind of
veer
away from it. And this is you in her favorite place in Sanibel.
On Sanibel Island, we always went back to this particular place. It's about the only place on Sanibel where you can be by the Gulf and not be rich. And Hillary did not want a gravestone. She didn't want to be buried. And what I have decided to do is scatter her ashes roughly right here at this. This was her favorite place in the world. And the knowledge that she would eventually get to come back there that would be a good thing.
I want to end this on another really positive note. Like William Inge, you are an avid art collector, museum quality art. And so we want to share with the audience some recent news.
Yes. Hillary, I started collecting just before I met Hillary, and it was a joint project after that. We didn't want it to be buying at random, and we're not rich. So we bought limited edition prints of mid-century modern American artists, and I was quite systematic about this. Over the decade and a half that we collected, we have about 60 pieces. What you are seeing here is in my living room. Upper left is an etching by Richard Diebenkorn. Below it, a dry point by Milton Avery. Upper right is a screen print with added paintwork by Hans Hoffman. Below it, an etching by John Marin. And in the center is a lithograph by Joan Mitchell. So that's a lot of art. And most of it hangs here. I always expected it to go to Hillary. I mean, I suppose if I'd been realistic, I would have known that I would outlive her, but I didn't think that way. And then she died, and I began to think, I need to decide what I'm going to do with all this art after I go. So I got in touch with a museum we both love in Connecticut, the New Britain Museum of American Art, the first museum in the United States ever devoted exclusively to American painting. And I emailed them a list of the collection, and I said, I'm thinking that maybe I would like to leave this to you, and I would like it to be shown as the Hillary Teachout Memorial Collection. And they got right back to me. And so we're working out the details now, but we're hoping that there will be a small permanent gallery that will hold maybe five or six pieces, because you don't hang works on paper nonstop. They have to be rotated. So perhaps we'll have an exhibition of the entire collection once we make the deal. And then they'll rotate these pieces in forevermore, I hope.
Isn't it nice to be treated like you're rich now?
It's a new feeling. but the most important thing is it's Hillary didn't want a gravestone. And I think that scattering her ashes at Sanibel is the right thing to do. But I wanted to have some kind of permanent memorial to her, because she transformed my life, made me into a playwright and a director, really. I mean, she was the one who believed in all sorts of things I couldn't begin to describe here. And I like the thought of knowing that she will be remembered that way. There will be a plaque on the wall that will explain who she was,
beautiful,
what she went through.
It's beautiful. Beautiful way to go. Do it. That's beautiful, brother. I'm going to open up the floor.
I got through that in one piece. I wasn't sure I would.
This has been, I'm sure. This has been the longest Dramalogue interview in our history. So I'm going to get some slack about that. But we're going to open the floor for about 5 minutes here to see if there's any questions from the house.
Well, we have our lovely Marlene Silver.
Marlene Silver, by the way, is the sponsor. She and Martin, her husband, are sponsors of this series. So thank you, Marlene. Good to have you.
Hi, thank you.
I've met you both, right?
Yes, you have.
Of course.
I just have to tell you how wonderful this evening has been. It's never too long, Bill. I love this whole format, and especially with you, Terry. It's just been amazing to learn about you and your background and your history, and you really have done it all in the whole world of theater, music, dance. It's incredible.
Well, you're very kind to say so.
So in awe of the span, you know, of your talent. But my question, if I can remember how I wrote it, I actually, but it's in there, Bruce. If you have it, as a critic.
I do, yes, and it's a great question. What was your reaction to the critics who wrote reviews of your works? With the tables turned, how did that reveal new lessons about the art of being a critic?
Well, I got good reviews. I mean, there was one half-wit on the West Coast. I remember that. But basically, people liked the show. I always tell people not to read their reviews, and I cheated because I was curious. And they were gratifying. Mm.
Yeah. I'm sure there's a structure and an art form to writing a review. And so I, you know, curious because it comes so personal, I think, you know, this is something that, you know, you've created now, and, you know, now you have somebody else judging it, you know, so how does that work?
Well, Marlene, I'll tell you something else that has happened. I have now reached the point where Satchmo has been produced so much that I haven't even seen the last 10 productions or so. There's one actually going up somewhere in Florida. And another, I forget where it is. I think it might be in North Carolina. But I guess this is what it's like when you have a child that grows up and goes off on its own. There are people doing this play, and I hope they do it well. But it's all theirs now. It's not mine anymore. And that's an interesting feeling.
And Marlene, you eventually learn as a director not to read the reviews anymore.
Part of getting
if I get another chance, I'll remember that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Marlene. You have a good weekend.
Yes, you too. Thank you. It's been wonderful. Just really enjoyed this session. Fantastic.
It's nice to hear your voice, Marlene.
Thank you. Yours too.
Marlene also asked about the Jazz Baroness. Did you ever see the documentary, The Jazz Baroness, about Thelonious Monk and...
The Baroness Nika, yes, good heavens, yeah. Whose last name I can't pronounce, but...
But do you think there's a play in that story?
You know, there is, but when one of the characters is severely mentally ill and reverted to silence for the last few years of his life, it presents some very special technical problems, but Also, I don't want to write another play about jazz. I mean, I don't want to get any more typecast than I am. But I could imagine somebody writing something quite interesting about the Baroness Nika, because she was quite a cat. I know quite a few people who knew her, as a matter of fact.
Yes, you know everybody, sir. Bruce, do we have any more?
Diane just said with a comment. Hi, Diane, are you with us?
Yes.
There she is. Hi.
Hi, yes. Oh, no, I enjoyed this so much.
I enjoyed it too, Diane.
So much tonight. It was wonderful.
I'm loving
everything that you're doing in Dramaworks, and I'm loving the fact that I'm hearing there's going to be more online stuff coming, because I think that's, you know, I'm 77. It's hard for me to get to the theater anymore, but I can sit here in my bedroom and watch it and think.
And I've learned in this last year, Diane, that you can have a complete theatrical experience sitting at home.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of critics were a bit snooty about that, but it's just not true. You can watch it with headphones, you can watch it on a computer, and it's meaningful and involving. Everybody should do it.
Yes, and I've been watching the Dramaworks presentations, and they've gotten better. I mean, you know, markedly better over the last, since the end of August when I started watching them.
Thank you so much. We're trying to figure it out, Diane. It takes some.
Okay. It takes practice.
A learning curve for sure.
Thank you, Diane.
You have a good weekend. And we'll take one more if there's another question, and then we're going to call it a night.
There are several here, but specifically about you, is directing your favorite part of the journey so far?
Yes. Yes, it is. That surprises me, since it's the most recent part. But to suddenly start doing a new thing at 60 and discover that you're pretty good at it, I long to do it again. As I say, I long to do it to somebody else's work. I'd be perfectly happy to stage Satchmo again for somebody, but, you know, I have done that now. I think maybe I have it in me to do another play by another person. So I hope I get the chance, but I would certainly say that my two stints doing Satchmo are the most pure fun I have ever had in the theater. I'm sitting writing something, there is no fun to it whatsoever. And it's, you're not even present. You don't even think about it. You're just completely involved. And when you're directing, you're not the only person in the room.
All right, Bruce, I'm going to be very generous tonight. We're going to take one more.
Okay. Actually, we have one of our playwrights from the festival, Oren Safdie. Oren, are you with us?
Oren Safdie, what a good playwright.
Yes, I am here, and it's great to watch this. It's really...
Hi, Oren.
Hi. And nice to meet you, Terry.
It's nice to talk to you. I have written of your work with admiration more than once.
Thank you, and I always have appreciated it. But I had a question, which is kind of a little bit maybe humorous, because I always wondered, and I've seen this more lately, that sometimes the reviews you write of plays are completely diametrically opposite of what the New York Times reviews. And I'm wondering if you get a chuckle at that, or if you... how you sort of think that happens, and if it's happening more, if it's political, or what do you think?
It's not political. I mean, it's, well, of course, the funny answer to your funny question is I'm right. Now we all approach things differently. We see them differently. We have different priorities. I'm old enough to feel secure in my own views. When you're younger, you may feel threatened by other people's opinions. But I don't feel threatened by people who disagree with me at all. And of course, Ben is retired now, but I always looked at what Ben wrote. And he was a guy who, whether we agreed or not, and we agreed more often than not, I found, you could tell that he liked theater. There is nothing more poisonous in this world than a critic who is cynical about the art form that he or she covers. And I will not name any names, past or present, but they do exist. They're burned out cases.
I'll name them.
None of that. But they're out there. And I'm the opposite of cynical. I'm the opposite of jaded. And I hope it shows.
It does.
Yes.
Professionally and personally.
I was just going to say, as I told you, that I'm very sorry to hear about Hillary, but as I wrote to you when you told me about the transplant, the first thing I did was go out and change my driver's license, and it really motivated
me. Yeah, it might be worth mentioning, Bill, that I put the word, people have been following Hillary through my Twitter feed for a long time. And when I put out the word that she had not made it past the transplant, my tweets about her received several hundred thousand hits, and they led to many, many, many people becoming organ donors. She would have liked that. I'm proud that I was able to do that. And I hope that all of you listening will keep that in mind. You can save a life. You can save several lives as an organ donor. Please consider it.
We will end on that. Oren, thank you so much, and you have a good weekend.
Thank you. You too.
Terry, you're an extraordinary human being. You are a walking encyclopedia, and you have a heart the size of Manhattan. You're one of the greatest souls I've ever known. You're a wonderful artist, a wonderful friend. I love you so much. You are my brother. And it was nice to spend a couple of hours with you. And I can't wait to bring you back home here to Palm Beach Dramaworks and get you back into a rehearsal hall.
Oh, man. I'll be glad to be back. And everything you said, that's how I feel about you.
Thanks for spending the night with me. Ladies and gentlemen, you have a good weekend. And as always, I want to remind you that love is also highly contagious. Have a good night. Thank you.